We will restart proceedings and will proceed with the division on Amendment 3, and members should cast their votes now. And that's the vote closed. The result of the vote on Amendment number 3 in the name of Jeremy Balfour is yes 42, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. We now move on to Group 3, reorganisations. I call Amendment 6 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendments 7, 8 and 12. Cabinet Secretary, to move Amendment 6 and speak to all the amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I highlighted at stage 2 that this is not a straightforward area of the law and there may be need for some further technical refinement of this stage at stage 3 once detailed feedback from charities, legal professionals and OSCAR had been received. These amendments are brought forward following those discussions and primarily refine and clarify the provisions added to the Bill on the reorganisation of endowments at stage 2. They do so in two specific ways. First, Amendment 6 removes charities established by Royal Charter or Royal Warrant from the scope of what will be new Section 42(6)(b) of the 2005 Act. This will mean that those charities can reorganise their endowments, but not the entire charity. This is being done in order to target the provisions more accurately at the charities most likely to hold only endowment property. No Royal Charter or Royal Warrant charity has ever tried to seek a reorganisation scheme, so this is most likely a theoretical change only, but we think it is appropriate that the provisions do not go wider than is necessary or appropriate. Secondly, Amendments 7 and 8 ensure that the income derived from an endowment is treated as part of the capital sum and may be included in a reorganisation scheme proposed by a charity under the new provisions. Otherwise, charities might have to apply for a second reorganisation scheme to reorganise the restricted funds which compromise the income, or they might have to spend the income prematurely to dispose of it. Those are not consequences we would want. Finally, Amendment 12 seeks to clarify that where a charity of any type has varied its constitution by way of a reorganisation or by other means, references in the 2005 Act to the charity's constitution means the constitution as varied. This reflects what we understand already happens in practice, but we believe was intended by the 2005 Act and simply ensures there is no room for ambiguity. So I move Amendment 6.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The question is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is agreed. I call Amendment 7 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 6. Cabinet Secretary, to move or not move?
Move.
Question is that Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is agreed. I call Amendment 8 in the name of Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 6. Cabinet Secretary, to move or not move?
Move.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is agreed. We move to Group 4, OSCAR's Communication and Charities. I call Amendment 1 in the name of Jeremy Balfour in a group on its own. Jeremy Balfour to move and speak to Amendment 1.
Thank you, Deputy President Officer. I brought forward an amendment at Stage 2, and I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for helping me in regard to bringing forward perhaps better amendment at this stage, which I hope will get the support of the whole chamber. This amendment enhances OSCAR's existing reporting duty, adding a new requirement that the annual report must contain information about what action OSCAR has taken to raise awareness and understanding in charities about the steps we need to take and comply with charity law. We did take quite a lot of evidence at stage one that many charities, whether large ones or small ones, often just didn't know what was being asked of them, and I think there is a duty on OSCA to provide more information. OSCA will be required to produce a general annual report to be laid before Parliament, and this amendment adds to this existing duty, allowing for ongoing scrutiny by Parliament of OSCA's communication with charities, which I think allows committees and others to be involved in that. The report will cover communications with charities about all the relevant legislation, not just the changes made by this bill, and this should help to address the concerns that we got at stage one about the lack of awareness among the sector on existing requirements, as well as concerns about new requirements introduced this bill. OSCA will be able to incorporate this communications reporting into its existing annual report process, ensuring efficient use of OSCA's resources. I do think this will give more clarity to the third sector, and I hope that the Chamber can support it this afternoon.
Thank you. I call Paul Kane.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and forgive me, I should have in my previous contribution declared an interest as the Chair of Trustees of Neilson War Memorial Association. I rise to speak very briefly in support of this amendment. I think, as Jeremy Balfour has outlined, communication and understanding the obligations that are placed upon charities was a key part of the evidence that was heard in committee, and very often the anxiety of charity trustees not knowing whether they are indeed being fully compliant with what is expected of them. I think it's important that OSCA outlines clearly how they intend to do that and to review indeed their communication strategies to ensure that no charities are left in the dark when we reflect on the changes that will come about thanks to this bill. So we on this side of the chamber will certainly support this amendment, and we would encourage colleagues to do likewise.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm grateful to Jeremy Balfour for raising this issue at stage two, and we have worked with him on this amendment, which enhances OSCA's existing reporting duties. By adding a new requirement that the annual report must contain information about what actions OSCA has taken to raise awareness and understanding by charities about the steps they need to take to comply with the 2005 Act, the Parliament and the public will be able to scrutinise OSCA's communications with charities. The report will cover communications with charities about the 2005 Act as a whole, as well as the changes made by this bill. This will address the concerns about a lack of awareness amongst the sector with regard to some existing requirements, as well as the concerns about the new requirements introduced by this bill. OSCA will be able to incorporate this communications reporting into its existing annual reporting process, ensuring an efficient use of OSCA's resources, and I would therefore encourage members to support Jeremy Balfour's amendment.
Thank you, Jeremy Balfour. To wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 1.
Should we move Amendment?
Thank you very much. The question is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is agreed. I call Amendment 9 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 4. Cabinet Secretary, to move or not move?
Moved.
Question is that Amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is agreed. We move to Group 5, Data Protection. Call Amendment 10 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Grouped with Amendment 11, Cabinet Secretary, to move Amendment 10 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Presiding Officer, the 2005 Act already makes provision about information sharing between OSCA and others, and a slight expansion to that existing provision was made by amendment at Stage 2. The changes which were made at Stage 2 tie into existing language in the 2005 Act, which refers to being able to share information despite any restriction on disclosure. The type of restriction meant by that is, for example, the rule in Section 29(4) of the 2005 Act, which restricts OSCA restricts how OSCA can use information provided to it for the purpose of an inquiry. These amendments make clear, for the avoidance of doubt, that the provision in Section 25(1) of the 2005 Act, as amended at Stage 2, relating to information sharing, is not intended to override data protection legislation. While the amendment does not make a change of substance, we consider it appropriate and helpful for the avoidance of doubt in the case of this specific reference. This aims to ensure clarity, drawing on the approach taken in some other UK statutes. And I move Amendment 10.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is agreed. I call Amendment 11 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 10. Cabinet Secretary, move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That is agreed. I call Amendment 12 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 6. Cabinet Secretary, to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed, and that ends consideration of amendments. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business. Okay, as members will be aware, at this point in the proceedings, the presiding officer is required under standing orders to decide whether or not, in her view, any provision of the bill relates to a protected subject matter, that is, whether it modifies the electoral system and franchise for Scottish parliamentary elections. In the case of this bill, in the presiding officer's view, no provision of the Charities Regulation Administration Scotland bill relates to a protected subject matter. Therefore, the bill does not require a supermajority to be passed at stage three. The next item of business is a stage three debate on motion 9725 in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville on Charities Regulation Administration Scotland Bill. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak to and move the motion around 7 minutes. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion in my name. And I'm pleased to open this Stage 3 debate on the Charities Regulation and Administration Scotland Bill. Let me start by thanking all the members, past and present, of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee during Stages 1 and 2 for their diligent scrutiny of the Bill and for their support for its measures and the amendments made. I'd also like to thank the clerks and staff of the Parliament who, as always, have provided support to MSPs throughout the passage of the Bill. And of course, I would like to thank my bill team for all their hard work, both for my predecessor, Shona Robison, and myself. I also want to highlight my gratitude to all the stakeholders who have taken the time to express their views on the bill through oral and written evidence to committee and through discussions with the Scottish Government. This evidence provided us with a clear understanding of the day-to-day experiences faced by charities across the country. As this is a technical bill, the contributions of legal professionals have also been invaluable to the refinement of the provisions. I'm of course grateful to OSCAR, the Scottish Charity Regulator, for its work over a number of years with the Scottish Government to get the bill to this point. OSCAR has been key to identifying the changes needed to modernise charity regulation, ensuring that public trust and confidence in charities remains high. And I would specifically like to thank OSCAR's legal and policy advisers for their expertise and input through this process. Presiding Officer, it is not often that we get a bill with so few amendments as this bill has had at Stage 2 and Stage 3. And on behalf of the Government, I wish all Stage 3s were as quick as this one has been. But I think on reflection, this is partly because of the cross-party support of this bill, as well as the technical nature of it. And I would like to thank the contributions from members and how we have approached the areas in which we have all attempted to make this legislation more improved as we have moved through the parliamentary process. And I think that is based on the fact that we recognise that the charity sector is a vital partner to all of us in society. And certainly it is a vital partner to government in supporting our communities. Many of us, right across the chamber and across the country today, are involved with charities in our personal capacity, either as a trustee or as a volunteer, and are very aware of their work in our constituencies and just how much they contribute day in, day out. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank all the volunteers and staff that give their valuable time and energy to this essential sector. You are all critical to the health and well-being of our people, places and communities. And, of course, I would also like to thank all the people who support charities through donations, in whatever form they may be. The latest sector overview report from OSCAR sets out that Scottish charities have a combined income of over £14 billion each year. This clearly demonstrates how widely they are supported by the public, which in turn can only happen if the public trust charities. Research shows that trust in charities and what they deliver is high, and we all want to keep it that way. On Friday, I had the pleasure of attending the Scottish Charity Awards organised by SCVO and was genuinely humbled by the passion and innovation in that room. This was exemplified by the winners of the Charity of the Year, Diversified. Established in Livingston, Diversified is Scotland's first autistic and neurodivergent youth-led charity. They use their own lived experience to help design and lead services for neurodivergent young people. It was a real pleasure to meet them at the awards on Friday, and it was a real pleasure indeed to see all the finalists receive their awards. We did not talk much about charity regulation and charity law on that night, but I hope it forms the basis of the trust that people can have in charities to allow all those individuals to carry out the good work that they do. And I'm sure members will all agree when I say that the talent and the breadth of experience in Scotland's charity sector is truly exemplary and something we can all be proud of. This government's focus is to ensure the best possible conditions for the charity sector to thrive and support our communities, and that is the aim of this bill. Members will be aware that there is a significant support for this reform and modernisation of Scottish charity law. There is also a desire from many who work in and with charities for a broader review of the future of charity regulation, and I recognise that. This is why I have agreed that following the passage of this bill, the Scottish Government will initiate a wider review of charity regulation, and I want to repeat that commitment here today and make clear that we will start conversations with the sector, including the SCVO, this year on the scope of that review. Now on to the details of this bill. It does provide practical improvements and updates to existing charity regulation, namely the Charities and Trustee Investment Scotland Act 2005. The bill is built around proposals put forward by OSCAR based on its operational experience since that Act came into force. In addition, following engagement with OSCAR and the Law Society of Scotland, the record of charity mergers at Section 12 of the bill was added, as was a list of minor or technical amendments, including in the schedule. The bill has a range of different provisions designed to enhance the existing framework. Each of the provisions falls under one of three primary aims. The first aim is to increase transparency and accountability in charities by improving public access to information about a charity's operations. The second aim is to provide stronger powers for OSCAR, including the power to issue positive directions to help charities address regulatory issues. And the third, that the bill brings Scottish charity law up to date with some key aspects of charity regulation in England, Wales and Northern Ireland, enhancing public trust in charities and further protecting charitable assets. Presiding Officer, I valued very much the committee's positive conclusions and constructive recommendations in its Stage 1 report, in particular the recommendation to include a review and an appeals process for any disputes in relation to OSCAR's ability to appoint interim trustees, which resulted in the government amendments at Stage 2. I've also listened to members in the committee's views and recommendations around communicating these legislative changes. I wrote to the committee to set out the government's plans for commencement of the bill, as has OSCAR, which has confirmed it will share its draft communications plan with the committee for their consideration in advance of engaging with the sector. In addition, of course, Amendment 1, with Jeremy Balfour's assistance, will enhance OSCAR's reporting duties, ensuring that it sets out its annual report to Parliament, the work carried out that year, to promote awareness and understanding amongst the sector of the requirements of charity law. I was also pleased that at Stage 2 we were able to bring forward some clarifications to the rules around reorganisations of endowments held by statutory charities. While only impacting on a small number of charities, the costs involved in such reorganisations can be substantial for the organisations involved. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, this bill makes practical improvements and updates to existing charity regulation and the role of OSCAR. It's intended to sustain the effective and supportive regulation of charities during what we know are challenging times for the sector. There is broad agreement from members and stakeholders on the general principles of this bill and its importance in helping us deliver continued support to Scotland's charities. And I therefore move that the Parliament agrees that the Charities Regulation and Administration Scotland Bill be passed.
Thank you. I now call on Jeremy Balfour, up to 6 minutes, Mr Balfour, and we do have time in hand this afternoon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I welcome this debate and look forward to this bill becoming an act. Can I add my thanks to that of the Cabinet Secretary, for the Bills team, for the clerks and staff here in the Parliament, and for all those that gave evidence to the committee at stage one. One of the things that became quite clear as we took evidence was, I think it would be fair to say, that this is an Oscar bill rather than a third sector bill. It is very technical in many ways, and it has clearly been driven by Oscar in regard to it coming forward this afternoon. And I think there is agreement amongst everyone within this chamber of the importance of the third sector and the role that they play within Scotland, whether that is in regard to volunteering, whether that is in regard to giving, whether that is being a trustee of a charity. But we do have to be aware that society is changing, and volunteering, and I say this as one of the communities of a volunteering cross-party group, volunteering post-pandemic is becoming harder for people to do, and many organisations are struggling to find volunteers to come on board. And that is perhaps more true in regard to whether they are being asked to be a trustee with all that legal responsibility that comes with that appointment. And I do think over the next number of months and years, as the Scottish Government consult, we do have to have a wider conversation as to what role does the third sector have to play within our society, how do we encourage more people to volunteer, and how do we make sure that charities are able to do what they want to do locally and nationally. That, I think, will pose some really interesting questions. And I think the other overwhelming remark that came back as we took evidence was that there is a desire within charities, within the third sector, to see reform and to see greater reform than this bill brings forward. And I do hope that that consultation that the Cabinet Secretary referred to in her opening speech will not be over time-consuming. Yes, we do need to speak. Yes, we do need to consult. But we also need to be able to bring forward legislation in the next session. I think the bill, as we have it today, is a good bill. It could have been better if my amendment had been accepted. But we still have a bill that I think will give that transparency, that openness, but it will also give a bit more clarity in regard to the role of trustees and what they can do and what they should do. I'm pleased that the Chamber did accept my amendment, because there was, again, some criticism that Oscar perhaps hadn't been communicated in such a way that it's the information that they want to get to charities is actually getting through. Presiding Officer, we welcome this bill on this side. We look forward to have been implemented, and we look forward to seeing, most importantly, the third sector grow and flourish over the next number of years. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and I now call on Paul O'Kane, up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to have the opportunity to speak in the Stage 3 debate this afternoon. I have previously referred to my register of interest as a charity trustee, and it is, of course, a great joy and an honour to be a charity trustee, as I'm sure many other members in the Chamber and many people across Scotland feel that sense of pride in the charities that they work for. And I think it's important that we bear that in mind as we discuss these issues today that will directly impact them and the charities that they do so much good work for. I would also put on record my thanks to everyone involved in bringing this bill to its conclusion. Of course, in the classic style of this place, I came late to the day, joined the committee just to approve the Stage 1 report and then to take part in the Stage 2 proceedings. So all of the hard work was done by my colleague Pam Duncan-Glancy, who worked with our committee colleagues to take the bill through its various evidence sessions, and I think really gave a lot of robust challenge to government at various points to ensure that we have the best bill possible today. So I should thank Pam Duncan-Glancy for that, and indeed, as I say, thank everyone involved from the clerking team and the bill team and all those who have worked to improve the bill. Also, as I said in my outset, I think we should take an opportunity to thank all those who are involved in charities across Scotland. We heard from the Cabinet Secretary some of the really impressive statistics of the work that is done by charities in Scotland and indeed the money that they raise for a whole range of charitable causes. So I think it's important we put on record our thanks to them. Scottish Labour will support the passage of the bill this afternoon. We believe the bill to be a welcome and overdue step to reform charity legislation. We believe it will increase the transparency and accountability of charities, which we think is important in progressing and bringing the key aspects of charity law into line with other regulatory frameworks across the UK, in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. I will take some time, if I can, Presiding Officer, to focus on where I think we can go further, and I am heartened again to hear the Cabinet Secretary's commitment to that wider review of charity regulation and law and that engagement with SCVO. But I think it can't just be about the structures. We actually have to take a fundamental look at how we can better support charities and the work that they do. And I highlighted in my contribution at stage one the importance of ensuring that we look at issues like the funding cycle for charities. Many charities live year to year in terms of the funding that they receive, either from government or from local authorities. And that can often prove challenging in terms of trying to plan for the future, trying to plan to make projects go beyond just that one-year phase. So something like three-year funding cycles has been talked about for a long, long time in this chamber, but we never seem to have got to a place where we are offering charities that three-year deal. And I think it would be really important in the conversations that the Cabinet Secretary has with SCVO to listen to their asks, to listen to their asks on behalf of the wider sector, and to try and bring that in very much to the scope, I think, of the work that she is keen to do more broadly on charity regulation and the advancement of charities here in Scotland. I will say something briefly, Presiding Officer, on the amendments that didn't make it today, the amendment brought in the name of Jeremy Balfour. I outlined my concerns in terms of the burdens that were placed on churches by the registering controlling interests in land. I do think that we have to look at that again. I won't re-rehearse the arguments I made in the Stage 3 Amendments debate, but I would ask the Cabinet Secretary to reflect on what she has heard here today, what she has heard across the course of this discussion and debate from churches and other religious organisations, and tell the Chamber essentially what further she feels can be done to engage properly with the churches to give them that comfort and support that they need in order to be compliant with the law, because I think the last thing we'd want to see is anyone who's involved in those organisations in good faith facing any kind of challenges because they haven't complied. So, Presiding Officer, I will bring my remarks to a close simply by once again reiterating our support for this bill. We will support it at decision time. We do feel that we can go further to support our charities in Scotland, and we are willing and open to work with anyone in that vein, and particularly to work with the Cabinet Secretary to ensure that the review covers all of the issues that I have mentioned and supports a good, thriving third and voluntary sector here in Scotland. I'm very grateful.
Thank you, and I now call on Maggie Chapman. A point of order, Murdo Fraser.
Grateful, Presiding Officer. And a point of order, when I made a contribution earlier in the debate on Mr Balfour's amendment, I referred to my register of interests, and it occurs to me I should probably have clarified I am the trustee of two Scottish registered charities and omitted to do at that point, so I just want to correct the record. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Fraser. While it is not a point of order, your comments are now on the record. Thank you. And I call Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On behalf of the Scottish Greens, I welcome the Charities, Regulations and Administration Scotland Bill, and I'm pleased to be able to say a few words in this debate today. I refer members to my register of interests. As someone who was not directly involved in the committee's scrutiny of this legislation, I would like to begin by thanking the Social Security and Social Justice Committee for their detailed work on what is a somewhat technical bill. I would also like to thank the bill's team and all those organisations, charities and legal organisations who have contributed in various ways to the work of the committee and for providing information and briefings to us as MSPs. Charities, the third sector, play a vital role in our communities and our lives. As I said at stage one, they often support us at some of the most difficult or challenging times in our lives, providing life-saving services, advocacy, constructive critique, resilience, fundraising, and so much more. The hard work of staff and volunteers often goes unseen and sadly undervalued. But our society would not function without these services and supports, and the often selfless and unrecognised work that so many contribute to our collective well-being. So I would like to take this opportunity to place on record my thanks for all those charities, particularly those in the North East, who seek to do this work every day in circumstances that are often becoming increasingly challenging. We have a responsibility, I think, to ensure that the regulatory framework within which these charities operate is up to date and fit for purpose. Scotland's charity law has not been significantly amended since 2005, and the legislation before us today aims to update the current system of charity regulation, as we've heard already, by improving transparency and accountability, enhancing public trust, and improving the efficiency of OSCA's operations. The bill does not represent a full review of charity law in Scotland, however, and I know I'm not alone, as Paula Kane and others have said, that we wish it went further. But I do welcome the Cabinet Secretary's comments earlier about plans for a review that does take the whole of the regulation and charity legislation into account. I look forward to that, because we must collectively ensure that that review is wide-ranging and considers how to support the sector in a future that will be very different to the world we inhabited in 2005. I've spoken before about the need for charitable concessions for a wider range of activities that are goods in and of themselves, that a wider range than the current definition of charitable purposes contains. Greens would also want to see explicit inclusion of each of the protected characteristics as described in our current equality legislation. But that is for that review that is to come. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I'd like to highlight that we all share responsibility for the provision of clear information to ensure the sector as a whole is aware of the provisions in this legislation that we will pass later today. There must be a shared understanding of the implications of this bill for charities and regulators alike. But given the nature of the discussions and debates on this bill to date, I have no doubt that we will all work together to make this a reality, and I look forward to doing that with colleagues across the Chamber. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to have the opportunity to speak today and want to reflect on some points drawing on my role as convener of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. I want to thank my colleagues and the clerks on the committee for their support and effort in scrutinising the bill, as well as the organisations who have engaged with us and provided evidence to inform the committee's scrutiny of the bill. The Charities Regulation and Administration Scotland Bill is long awaited. There have been calls from charities for reform, as well as from OSCA. Indeed, the plans for legislation are centred on practical proposals put forward by OSCA based on their experience as a regulator. The bill has also been shaped by input from other stakeholders who have provided a lot of valuable input. The bill represents a significant step forward in enhancing transparency, accountability and good governance within charitable organisations. Charities have said that they want these changes to help strengthen and update existing charity law. Current laws are now almost 20 years old, and the charity landscape has changed significantly in the intervening years. So it is right that the bill has been brought forward to update the current system of charity regulation in Scotland. The Scottish Government's focus is to ensure the best possible conditions for the charity sector to thrive and support communities. And I appreciate the Scottish Government intends to bring forward further reform for charities, and this is definitely a very positive step within the third sector. Meanwhile, this bill will improve OSCA's powers, allowing them to publish annual accounts for every charity, include the names of all charity trustees in the Scottish Charity Register, remove charities that fail to provide accounts and don't respond to OSCA's communications, and create a publicly researchable record of removed charity trustees. The legislation will also give OSCR new powers to issue positive directions to a charity to take action, such as managing a conflict of interest where a risk has been identified by the regulator. As I said in my Stage 1 debate, Chas put it well, saying charities are in a privileged position with regards to handling donations from the public. Those are things in relation to which public accountability is important. Therefore, the Scottish Government's proposed changes are important in order to maintain public trust and confidence in this important sector and in its regulator in the years ahead. If the bill is approved today, there must be an awareness-raising campaign in due course to ensure that forthcoming changes are widely communicated to charities and that there is no onus on charities in terms of the additional administration changes. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, for charities to continue to add value, we must ensure they are properly regulated and supported. The Charities Regulation and Administration Scotland Bill is generally regulatory in nature as opposed to anything more fundamental about charities, and it is right that we update these elements of current legislation. I support this bill and hope other members will back it tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. And we move to winding up, and I call on Paul O'Kane.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer, to rise on behalf of Scottish Labour to wind up in this bill. I think there is now a huge degree of consensus around the bill. I think, as I said in my opening, this bill can go forward. I think it could go further as well, which is vitally important. And I won't rehash those points because I think the Minister, the Cabinet Secretary, has heard them quite clearly. I don't know if they're heckling from the back, telling me to go on with it slightly, but no. I just wanted to add, I think, to what we've heard already, Presiding Officer, that it really is a privilege as a parliamentarian and for all of us to have the interaction that we do with charities in our work. I think we all get to experience in our constituencies and in our regions a huge breadth and depth of wonderful charities who are doing really amazing work. And actually, I was reflecting that in this place, we host charities probably more often than many places in Scotland on a daily basis. Every lunchtime or every evening in this Parliament, the place is usually brimming with different organisations coming to talk to their parliamentarians, and very often those are charitable organisations who do a range of important work, whether that be, you know, providing food parcels for older people, whether it be health charities who raise money for our children's hospices and hospitals, whether it be charities who support our armed forces and veterans community. It really is a great honour, as I say, to be able to engage with as many of them as we can. Indeed, this evening I will host a number of HIV charities from across Scotland as we talk about how we progress the route towards elimination of HIV in Scotland. And yes, Presiding Officer, that was a plug for my event this evening, so I do hope that colleagues in the Chamber will join me. Presiding Officer, I am very, very happy on behalf of Scottish Labour to reiterate once again our support for this bill. To reiterate the points I have made previously about ensuring that we do go further in the future. Also, I think, in terms of the point about how we deal with religious charities more broadly, I am keen to have further dialogue and discussion with the Cabinet Secretary, and I know that she has made that offer previously, and I'm sure she will in summing up as well. So I don't intend to detain the Chamber for much longer than I need to, other than to say this is a bill which I think does command now support from across the Chamber. I think it commands the support, certainly, of the regulator. I think the crucial test will it command the support in terms of its provisions, the support of charities across Scotland, and those charities that we all know from our communities. So that will be the next test of this, and it's why I think it's vitally important that we get the monitoring and the post-legislative scrutiny right before we move on to the next phase of that review. So I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer, and we will support the bill.
Thank you, and I call on Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I declare an interest as Chair of Heart Research UK's Heart of Scotland Appeal Board in Scotland as well. And as others have done at the start of this debate, can I also thank our clerks on the Social Justice and Social Security Committee who have helped us with the passage of the bill, but also those who have given evidence to the committee. And I think it is quite often humbling, actually, when you meet with charities and the third sector across Scotland to see that the work they are undertaking in our communities and just how vital that is and how we as a country wouldn't be who we are without them. And when you look at where our charities are having a combined income of over £15 billion, employing over 200,000 people in our country, that is why this bill was so important and parts of it concerning, and especially these points have been put with regards to our churches and faith groups and the potential unintended consequences of this bill. And I do hope, as other members have said, the Cabinet Secretary will really be mindful of that. And although we have welcomed that one-year delay, the concerns about bureaucracy and additional costs are still very much there. And I hope that we will see that taken on board, and potentially any amendments which need to be brought through Parliament in the future to prevent that costing our charities any money in the future, because that money needs to go to the front line during difficult times. And the arguments which have been put forward at stage 1, 2 and 3, I think still stand. Now, the charities law, which operates in Scotland, has been in place for some 18 years now, and so it has been necessary to modernise these laws to make how our charities operate more transparent. So we welcome that. And also the fact that this bill does now bring our charity law in Scotland in line with reforms in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. But as has been said by my colleague Jeremy Balfour, I think this has felt like it's an Oscar-inspired bill. And so there is an opportunity now with what potential reforms can come forward to do something radically different. And I welcome the fact that the Cabinet Secretary will now work to put together a proposed review during the rest of this Parliament and what that can mean, because I think it is really important, and Paul Kane outlined some potential reforms the Labour Party would like to see around regulation of charities. I also think we also need to look at the over-regulation of charities in Scotland as well. And during the stage one debate, John Mason, who I don't think is in the chamber, made some important points which I think can actually be taken forward for the fully volunteer charities we have in Scotland. Potentially, those charities who have an income of less than £25,000, who are facing the same bureaucracy and regulation in Scotland of charities with thousands of employees and millions of pounds of income. And I don't think that's fair, and I hope that we in future parliaments have that opportunity to look at actually the deregulation of how charities in Scotland operate and the opportunities that can present for resources to go to the issues they want to campaign on, they want to actually make a difference in. Because in many cases, and this is why I think actually the consultation did not attract as much engagement from these charities. These are looking after town halls or church halls across our country. They are small charities, and they just don't have the individuals to take on some of these roles. And so that is something I hope in the future, any potential consultation around this or the review which is proposed can really look at, because I think that could actually really realise the potential of many small charities across our country. In terms of decision time tonight, we will be supporting the bill as we've outlined. I think at this stage we are content with what the bill will do. But this has to present an opportunity for us to all look at how we support our charities. The third sector in Scotland, especially during the pandemic, did so much which we can be proud of. And I hope that that is the learning which we can take forward from this bill to actually, as a Parliament, look to how we can do more to help our third sector in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Shirley Ann Somerville to wind up to 5 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank all the members who have contributed to this small but perfectly formed debate that we've had this afternoon. I'd also like to take this opportunity to thank Oscar once again, who will of course be undertaking the work to ensure this bill is implemented successfully, and for their close and helpful cooperation with officials in the Scottish Government in the development and passage of the bill. This bill aims to enhance transparency and accountability in charities, improve Oscar's powers and maintain public trust in charities. Although it is a small and technical bill, it is nevertheless vital to the sector. Many colleagues, I think quite rightly, have begun to turn their attention to the wider review promised once this bill has passed. And I think the discussions that we have had as this bill has progressed will assist the government as it looks to scope that wider review out. So I would like to again thank colleagues for their remarks about this wider review. And I share with them the real importance of this, particularly as I accept that this bill is technical in nature that we're discussing today. I think we are all aware that the nature of the charity sector is changing, and it's changing rapidly, just as the changes in society that they are having to deal with are rapidly changing around them. Today's landscape with the growth of enterprising charities makes for a real different context than what we had in 2005, when the original Act was passed. So while it is right to ensure that the rules surrounding regulations and administrations of charities remain fit for purpose, which this bill does, we do recognise that there is more to do, whether that's around the role of charities, as Jeremy Balfour has mentioned, or around the importance of to recognise the needs of smaller charities that Miles Briggs has mentioned, although I would point out, of course, that charities under 25,000 already have, for example, simpler accounts that they have to produce. So we do take that into account, but I recognise there's more that we need to do. We will initiate a wider conversation on the longer-term future of charity regulation, and that is very, very important that, as a part of that, we address the concept of what a charity is in modern Scotland. So we will require extensive consultation and stakeholder engagement with the charity sector so we can define what the sector feels are the problems within the existing regime before we decide how to design the solutions. And I would always welcome the contribution of members from across the chamber as we scope this review out. It is very clear to us that we also have to be very conscious of the challenges that charities are facing right now, whether it's coming out of COVID or the cost of living impacting on charities' operations and funding streams, at the same time as many are seeing an increase in demand for services. And witnesses at the committee also spoke about the current lack of capacity within the sector to engage with and respond to consultations, and we need to be mindful of that in how we approach the review. Members have also quite rightly highlighted the concerns many charities have around funding, and I do absolutely recognise that the third sector needs stability and the opportunity for longer-term planning and development. And I would once again reiterate that the Government is committed to progressing a fairer funding approach to the third sector. Unfortunately, the volatile economic circumstances that we have at the moment have presented real additional challenges that have made it difficult to move forward with multi-year funding to the extent we would have wished for in the coming financial year. But we are keen to move forward with this and the wider, fairer funding approach, including prompt notification of funding, outcome-based flexible funding and proportionate administration around applications and reporting. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, this bill has been improved and strengthened as a result of the parliamentary process, and I'm very grateful to the members of the committee and other members in the chamber for their contributions to the debate. I believe we now have a bill that will help to strengthen the existing legislation, enhance transparency and accountability in charities, improve Oscar's powers and maintain public trust in the charity sector. I want to again stress the importance of the charity sector in Scotland. People up and down the country who volunteer, give their time, their energy and their money to truly commit and contribute to society, usually in an altruistic way, as they want to make a real and genuine difference to the community and the world that we live in. And I think it is important that the last word is for my thanks to them for all that they do for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the Stage 3 debate on Charities, Regulation and Administration Scotland Bill. It is now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Motion 9723 in the name of Tom Arthur on Economic Crime and Corporate Transparency Bill UK legislation. And I call on Tom Arthur to move the motion.
Moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of motion 9727 in the name of Martin Whitfield on the appointment of a new Scottish Information Commissioner. And I call on Martin Whitfield to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the selection panel.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. And as a member of the cross-party selection panel established by the Presiding Officer under our standing orders, I am delighted to be speaking to this motion in my name and to invite members of this Parliament to agree to nominate David Hamilton to His Majesty the King for appointment as the new Scottish Information Commissioner. Mr Hamilton would take up his appointment on the 16th of October 2023. The Presiding Officer chaired the selection panel, and the other members were Jim Fairley, Murdo Fraser, Gillian Mackay and Evelyn Tweed. This is an important appointment. The Scottish Information Commissioner is an independent office holder who is responsible for the promoting and enforcing of Scotland's freedom of information regime. The freedom of information gives everyone the right to access information held by Scottish public authorities. Freedom of information supports openness, transparency and accountability in the bodies that provide us with the public services. Freedom of information has been in place for 20 years, and there are currently two consultations being undertaken to reform the current regime. So the new commissioner will therefore be starting at an exciting but important time for FOI in Scotland. Turning to the nominee, who joins us with his family in the chamber today. David is a retired police officer, latterly serving as the chair of the Scottish Police Federation. David has held a number of non-executive roles and is currently the chair of his local community council. David is also an experienced aid worker who has just recently returned from Ukraine, where he was volunteering for the Edinburgh Direct Aid. The panel believes that David's skills and experience will make him an excellent commissioner. And finally, I would also like to mention the outgoing commissioner, Darren Fitzhenry, who will demit office later this year. And on a personal note, I would like to thank him for the work he has done, but I'm sure those across this chamber would also like to join me in thanking him and wishing him all the very best for the future. Presiding Officer, I move the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 9753 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme, and I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and moved.
Thank you, Mr. Adam. No member has asked to speak on the motion, and the question is that motion 9753 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motions 9754 and 9755 on stage one timetables for bills. And I ask any member who wishes to speak against the motions to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to move the motions.
Both move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motions. Therefore, the question is that motions 9754 and 9755 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motions are therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau motion 9756 on approval of an SSI. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motion.
Moved.
Thank you, Minister. And I call on Sarah Boyack.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I do want to confirm that Scottish Labour will support this SSI out of necessity today, but I do want to speak to it given the unusual circumstances we are in. The Minister admitted to the Net Zero Committee that further regulations will need to be laid after the summer recess to again delay the date in which DRS goes live in Scotland. So we don't need to have a re-debate on this, how we got here. We've had plenty of discussion on that. But what I would like to raise, Presiding Officer, is at this moment in time, as MSPs in the Parliament, and more importantly, producers, companies, the industry, they're still waiting to find out what the next steps are going to be, despite hundreds of millions of pounds of investment that have been made. So I was told that the Minister was due to meet MSPs from all parties to discuss the DRS, but the Minister cancelled that meeting. So Very keen that we hear what happens next, what ongoing discussions are, because we don't know what action the Scottish Government is now taking, what policy position the Scottish Government has, or indeed what the Scottish Government wants to see the UK Government doing in terms of the rolling out of a UK-wide scheme, which we understand is some time off. And there's always been a policy position of finding alignment where it's possible, but we need to make sure that we know what the position is so that there's an opportunity for the Parliament to help shape that alignment. So as I said at the beginning, we will support this SSI out of necessity, but it would be helpful to get an assurance from the Government today that the Minister in charge of the deposit return scheme will set out next steps to inform the Parliament what's going to happen next in terms of the Scottish Government's view on UK-wide implementation and what opportunities the Minister, Lorna Slater, is taking to work with other devolved governments and the UK Government to design a UK-wide deposit return scheme that works for us in Scotland and the other parts of the UK. And I would also suggest it'd be helpful for the Minister to meet with us on a cross-party basis when it is helpful, with opposition spokespeople, and that would be a way that we keep involved and that we know what's happening with the next steps in this scheme. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and I call on Minister Lorna Slater.
Presiding Officer, the regulations we are discussing today were laid on the 17th of May, before the UK Government's last-minute decision on the Internal Market Act, after almost 2 years of talks, which imposed unworkable conditions on our deposit return scheme, leaving it fatally undermined. Without the approval of the changes being made by these regulations, the go-live date would remain as the 16th of August this year, which nobody in this chamber wants to see happen. The regulations changed the go-live date to March next year. As I have previously explained, the UK Government intervention means that this date in turn is no longer possible, and I have committed to bring before Parliament further amendment regulations in line with parliamentary procedures and timelines to change that to the 1st of October 2025, reflecting the decision of the government that the government was forced to take on the 7th of June to delay the start of DRS and align with England. While this process is imperfect, it should be noted that options were extremely limited given the last minute and unexpected nature of the UK Government's intervention that meant that the regulations previously passed by this Parliament were no longer deliverable. If the Scottish Government had withdrawn these regulations and laid a new set, this would have meant seeking the agreement of Parliament to an expedited scrutiny process before summer recess, removing all of the normal committee and parliamentary scrutiny time, or the alternative would have been to suggest that Parliament should be recalled. Neither of these options was felt to be appropriate. As well as changing the start date, these regulations simplify the scheme for small businesses in particular. These changes came out of constructive dialogue with businesses. The UK Government have indicated that similar provisions are likely to be made in the English scheme. And while we still eventually may need to adjust the regulations again to align with them once they have designed their scheme, I believe it is important not to lose the progress that we made in Scotland through positive, constructive engagement with business. Continuing with these draft... Certainly.
Sarah Boyack.
It was really just to clarify that we totally accept we need to pass these regulations today, but in the spirit of trying to get us to a better place where we get regulations that we can all live with, will the Minister meet with opposition spokespeople and those of us who are really interested in getting it right to make sure we can come together and get the right scheme? Thank you.
Minister.
We are absolutely committed to getting the right schemes. Last week, I have met with Minister Rebecca Powell to discuss how we want to move forward collaboratively and collectively. The issue is that the matter is currently with DEFRA to develop their scheme. Now, the officials from DEFRA have come up to Scotland this week to look at what we've been doing here to understand what we're going forward. But we're really in the situation of waiting for the UK government to define the English scheme before we even have anything to discuss. Our scheme is now, through these regulations, completely defined, with only that draft amendment regulation, so with only the further amendment to come to bring us to the October 2025 date, which I will be bringing to Parliament shortly. We are absolutely committed to working forward, and as soon as we have something from DEFRA to discuss, I would be delighted to discuss that with opposition members, absolutely, so we can move forward with that. So we are committed to working to deliver this deposit return scheme in Scotland, giving the many positive environmental and economic benefits that it will bring. The detail of this does now depend on the scheme being developed by DEFRA. In the meantime, we are today providing businesses with absolute clarity that the deposit return regulations will not apply from this August, and that the measures the Scottish Government developed and agreed with business in recent months will help form the basis of the development of our new scheme.
Thank you. And the question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of 9 Parliamentary Bureau motions. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move motions 9720 on committee duration, 9756 and 9757 on approval of an SSI, 9758 to 9760 on designation of a lead committee, 9787 on approval of an SSI, 9761 and 9790 on committee membership, and 9791 on committee substitutes.
All moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. The question on these motions will be put at decision time. And I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now. And I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
You're killing me, Presiding Officer. I've moved.
Thank you. And the question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed? We are agreed, and there are 5 questions to be put as a result of today's business. And the first is that motion 9722, in the name of Angela Constance, on Northern Ireland Troubles, Legacy and Reconciliation Bill, UK legislation, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will have a short suspension to enable members to access the digital voting system. Ah. Clearly, I was not in the chair earlier, where members have been voting, and I am out of sync. So please do cast your votes now. Thank you. The vote is closed. Point of order, Russell Finlay.
App catastrophe. I would have voted no.
Thank you. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, Willie Rennie.
My app is not working. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. Rennie. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, David Torrance.
I couldn't connect to the app. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. Torrance. We'll ensure that's recorded. I call Co-Cap Stewart.
Point of order. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I couldn't get connected. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Ms. Stewart. We'll ensure that's recorded. I call Mercedes Vialba for a point of order.
My app wouldn't connect. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Ms. Vialba. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on motion 9722 in the name of Angela Constance is yes 83, no 27. There were no abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 9725 in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville on Charities Regulation and Administration Scotland Bill be agreed, and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. Point of order, Willie Rennie.
Map still not working. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. Rennie. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, David Torrance.
My app couldn't connect. I would have voted yes.
Thank you. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, CoCab Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My system is still not letting me in. I would have voted yes.
Thank you. We'll ensure that's recorded. Rhoda Grant.
Sorry. I did vote, Presiding Officer, but it now says my vote didn't register.
I can confirm that your vote has not been registered, Ms. Grant. Could you please repeat that? I'm sorry. Just couldn't hear you.
I would have voted yes.
Thank you. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on motion 9725 in the name of Shirley Ann Somerville is yes, 108. There were no votes against, there were no abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed, and the Charities Regulation and Administration Scotland Bill is passed. Thank you. The next question is that motion 9723 in the name of Tom Arthur on Economic Crime and Corporate Transparency Bill, UK legislation, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 9727, in the name of Martin Whitfield, on appointment of the Scottish Information Commissioner, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And I propose thank you. I propose to ask a single question on 9 Parliamentary Bureau motions. Does any member object? No member objects. The final question is that motions 9720 on committee duration, 9756 and 9757 on approval of an SSI, 9758 to 9760 on designation of a lead committee, 9787 on approval of an SSI, 9761 and 9790 on committee membership, and 9791 on committee substitutes, in the name of George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motions are therefore agreed. That concludes decision time, and we will now move on to members' business in the name of Russell Finlay.